If you happen to think killing two birds with one stone is a bit inefficient, or you found your way into a zombie apocalypse, you might be interested in a special type of gun known as a punt gun. This is actually a gun that used to be somewhat common among commercial waterfowl hunters. So, what's so special about this gun? Well, it's capable of killing upwards of 50 to 100 birds in a single shot. Market hunters first made their appearance in what would become the United States around the time of the Pilgrims, and continued plying their trade en masse until around the beginning of the 20th century. Some earned their living by bringing as many ducks or other waterfowl to market as possible. While various methods were used for bringing down the maximum number of birds per hunting trip, the most effective was ambushing a large flock with a punt gun. First put into use in the 1800s, the first punt guns were never manufactured on a large scale, with each being custom made by a gunsmith to fit a buyer's specifications. But in general, the barrels had openings upwards of 2 inches, that's 5 centimeters in diameter, and weighed over 100 pounds, that's 45 kilograms. They generally could fire more than a pound of shot at a time, and usually measured over 10 feet, that's 3 meters long. As you might imagine from this, they were too heavy and the recoil too strong for a hunter to fire them by hand. Instead, they were usually mounted to small, often flat-bottomed boats known as punts. Hunters aimed the gun by maneuvering the boat into a position 1 or 2 dozen meters from their targets, and then they fired. That said, not all punt guns were always mounted to boats. One of the smallest examples of a punt gun is known as Herforth's cannon. Created by German gunsmith August Herforth in Wisconsin, it measures 63 inches, that's 160 centimeters long, and includes a 46-inch, that's 116 centimeter long, Remington octagonal barrel with a 1-inch diameter. As for the weight, it's approximately 26 pounds, or just under 12 kilograms, making it a featherweight compared to most punt guns. However, it is still much too big and has too much kick to be fired like a normal shotgun. However, its smaller size did allow the hunter to hunt from the shore if it was properly braced against something. On the other end of the spectrum, the world's largest punt gun was Irish Tom. This was reported to have taken down a little over 100 birds with a single shot, according to its original owner. However, a more usual haul per shot was in a range of about 50 birds, give or take a dozen or two. Irish Tom's barrel measures more than 14 feet long, that's 4.2 meters, and the whole gun weighs more than 300 pounds, that's 136 kilograms. More akin to a cannon than a shotgun, it could fire over 3 pounds of shot with the help of about 10 ounces of black powder. The size of Irish Tom meant its first owner was forced to build a specially reinforced punt boat, which was 24 feet long. Market hunters used punt guns from the 19th through the early 20th century. The hunters often worked in groups of 8 to 10 and fired their combined punt guns at the same time to maximize the number of waterfowl that they could hit. As an example of how effective this was, a market hunter in the eastern United States, Ray Todd, claims he and 3 other hunters with punt guns managed to kill 419 ducks over one night in a single volley after encountering a huge flock over half a mile long and nearly as wide. After the first volley, he stated, "The birds flew off a short distance and began to feed again. We made 3 more shots that night. By morning, we had killed over 1,000 ducks. They brought $3.50 a pair in Baltimore, and it was the best night's work we had ever done." Not surprisingly, in the years after market hunters began using punt guns, the population of wild waterfowl began to decline in the United States rather dramatically. Punt guns most certainly played a role in the decline, along with the decrease in available habitat. Sportsmen who hunted for personal use of the killed waterfowl rather than for profit, like the market hunters, began advocating for hunting regulations and limits. In response, many states in the US outlawed the use of punt guns in the 1860s, while the Lacey Act of 1900 and the Migratory Bird Treaty Act of 1918 effectively ended their use in the country. That said, punt guns are still legal in the United Kingdom, though their barrels are restricted to a diameter less than 1.75 inches. Hunters must also have a permit from the government for the gun and the black powder, and they must adhere to strict hunting seasons. All this hasn't proved much of a problem, as there are only a few dozen currently used punt guns left in the UK today. Thank you.
Now, if you're wondering about the shotgun shell that I'm carrying, this is a 4-gauge shotgun shell. So what type of gun does this go into? A wildfowler, of course. And at that, a 19.5-pound Winchester wildfowler. This wildfowler was made in England for the Winchester Repeating Arms Company. It was made for Thomas Bennett, the second president of the Winchester Repeating Arms Company and son-in-law to Oliver Winchester. Now this firearm is about 20% of my body weight, and so all I can say is that I don't really want to be shooting it anytime soon, but it was a gun that Thomas Bennett used during his lifetime.
Thank you. this video, I tried to hold the sword with only one hand. Right here, you'll see me resting the pommel in my waist, to make a lever replacing my second hand. Now I'm using my back. And my waist again. Ouch. This one is my favorite. And now the biggest challenge, to hold the sword in the air, with no help at all. Did you really believe that?
But you know, I'm not on duty right now, and Todd is suggesting that I could take a lot of work out of my play by just firing one shot off of the punt gun. Here we go, on the count of three. One, two, three. Oh, gee whiz! Wow! Holy cow!
Thank you. This particular cannon is a rifle gun. It is a 15-inch Brook rifle, and it is one of the guns recovered off the CSS Jackson, the ironclad that we have inside the museum.
So it's an all-original cannon.
The gun tube is original. The gun was cast in January of 1865. It'll fire 115-pound solid round up to 5 miles. And if you look right here, this piece is called a trunnion. It's got 7-inch. It's in Roman numerals. That's the size of the bore. The maker, this is the initials of the guy that proofs the cannon, basically. Commander of the Selma Ironworks in the last couple of years of the war. And then here is the date for the production of the gun. And on the other side, which I'm sure you're going to get photos of later, it'll give the weight of the weapon. And this is a 15,000-pound tube. It's 14,800 pounds. This is one of the most accurate large weapons produced during the Civil War. It is rifle. It is not a smoothbore cannon. And this weapon will fire a solid projectile that looks like a large bullet, which is what it is. It's a large bullet. It'll fire 115-pound solid round up to 5 miles. And the thing is, with these larger guns, when they cast them, the casting is usually imperfect, so they tend to burst. So Brook and others are working on a design to remedy that flaw. So what they do is, you think about the gun tube being cast iron. What Brook does is take wrought iron, heat it up, and then as the iron cools around the back of the tube here, it provides that extra strength to contain that explosion that projects the projectile downrange at the bad guy.
Starboard side, port side clear. Clear! Fire! Ready! Fire! Fire! Fire!
It was recovered from the river in about 1911, and has remained above ground since then. It's been moved several times from several buildings and locations. And then in the 1960s, it was delivered to the old museum. And basically right now, it's just a matter of keeping it painted in order to keep it from continuing to rust. But so far, because of the well-manufactured elements of it, it has remained in very good condition, which is a big reason why we continue to fire it from time to time.
Look at this. There's the, you know when you, there's the big toe and the other four toes down to the small toe, down to the heel. What's fascinating about this is anybody that does a study of this will notice this piece sticking out here. It's like when you put your foot in mud and you pull it out, your toes will lift up a little mud where your toes were, and that's exactly what seems to have happened here. This rough granite is just psh, thank you.
We're here with the biggest, baddest weapons to ever be used on waterfowl. We're in Central City, Iowa with my buddy Steve Reese. Steve, you gotta tell me, how did you come across these beasts?
Actually, they were a gift given to our pastor for our Aiming for a Cure Foundation and to help us raise money for children with cancer. Obviously, so this thing is just an intimidating piece to have in your hands.
These shoulder punt guns are beasts. This is a 2-gauge. And I'm not saying they didn't use it in a punt, but it was made to fire from the shoulder if you needed to. I just can't imagine. Let's take a look at how this thing might work in a boat. So we're just in a regular 16-foot John boat here, but these punt guns were made, oh man, that thing is heavy. These punt guns were made to go in a small sneak skiff. These market hunters were hunting for the table, but not their table. Tables in New York and Chicago and Philadelphia. So they needed to kill a lot of birds, and to do that, it took a lot of coordination between the gun, the gunner, and the punt. We're in a John boat here, but this is how it works. This gun has this oarlock that would have gone into a device on the front of a boat, but most of the punt guns were just laid up in a notch on the skiff. The gunner laid down with the buttstock running down his body, and he paddled with small hand paddles on each side. That's how they aimed the boats with these small hand paddles. Now, they draped bags of sand and bags of sea oats across the stocks of these things, have kickboards against the ribs of their boat because they knew when they pulled the trigger, when they slapped that trigger, oh, it was going to be bad. Now, I am happy to report that I am not going to shoot this gun, but we do have video. We don't have to imagine what it was like to pull the trigger on a big boy. One, two, three. Steve, did you see the recoil on that shot? It pushed that skiff back half a foot.
That was intimidating to watch, Eddie, but actually I like to watch the other skiff better with the sporting clays on the cardboard.
Man, that one shot just obliterates this thing. What's the future for these guns, do you think?
Well, these two guns are gonna help us raise money to help find a cure for cancer for children. They're donated to the Aiming for a Cure Foundation, and we're gonna fulfill that wish that these guns will be sold in an auction to help raise money for our foundation.
Oh man, that is an inspiring story. For guns whose sole purpose and design was to take out waterfowl, they might help kids one of these days live a much better life and a healthier life.
Absolutely amazing.
Once upon a time, punt guns were king of the marsh, a true one-shot wonder. And they've been a great walk down history lane for the checkout line.
been since you ran. She left a troublesome prison behind.
This planet ain't on.